Chapter 7. The lure of the city as well as migration has seen the population of the village drastically decline. But at one time everyone from this end of the village would have walked along this little path to get to the ferry, the shop, and then the train. Many walked it and never returned. Writing in 1905 from the nearby village of Lipa, a Croatian school teacher noted, "They are telling in the village that 15 are going to Fiume by train on their way to America." A Fiume was the Italian name for the Croatian seaport of Rijeka. And poverty in the village was the main reason that spurred many to take the train to Rijeka in order to migrate abroad. This teacher continued, "It is hard to till the fields, for there are no workers to be had. Whoever has strength and youth is at work in America. At home there are only the old men and women, and the young wives with their children." Around the time that he was writing, the steamship La Britannia was leaving the French port of Le Havre, heading across the Atlantic for New York. The ship's manifest reads like Bukovlje's school register, but where only the young boys are listed. Many of the surnames are from families in the village. On deck stood a certain Marko Fudorić, travelling with a relative, Juraj. Both married and in their mid-twenties, they left behind their families and the village of Bukovlje. Their destination was to relatives, and at least one of them was a member of the Domšić family, already resident in America. The close ties that existed between the Fudorić and Domšić families in Bukovlje clearly crossed the Atlantic intact. Just 3 months later, another Domšić from Bukovlje, Ivo, having made his way from our village to the German port of Bremen, boarded the ship, the Kronprinz Wilhelm. It too sailed for New York, and on its final approach passed the Statue of Liberty. It was surely a welcome sight for all those on board after a month at sea. Not long after his arrival, he naturalized his name to John, and makes for his destination, to a certain Uncle Fudorić, resident in Ohio. John Domšić was 21 and still single. 6 years later, in 1911, he is married to Eva, and in the census return for 1920, a father of three children, Paul, John and Annie. By the time of the following census, in 1930, we note that another daughter has been born, a certain Annie. Existing documents show that he served in the US Army in both the First and Second World Wars. John was finally granted citizenship in 1933. He died at the end of 1960, and a service was held in the nearby church of St. Paul, not far from his home. Even today, the Croatian community in Ohio still orientates itself around this church. John's obituary note reads that he was a grandfather of 9 and a brother of 7 back in Yugoslavia. He seems to have been a model citizen and made a comfortable life for himself in Cleveland. As far as I know, he never felt strong enough, the urge, as some do, that pulled them back to their homeland, and which might have spurned a visit from him or his family back to Bukovlje. The footsteps of members of the Fudorić and Domšić families, as well as those of the Maricic, Mihalic and Lukatic families, all left their imprint as they stumbled along this footpath down to the river Mrežnica and beyond. This path was the beginning of a long, arduous journey that took them across the globe, not just to America, but many of these families have relatives in Canada and Australia. While many generations have emigrated, others remained in Bukovlje to eke out an existence, simply to supplement the staple of the family table. The path now traverses the edge of our recently purchased field. It is largely stone and scrub, but some plants thrive in these poor conditions. As I pass, I inspect the lavender bushes that I planted and which are maturing nicely. And further, the new apple orchard, planted on the only part of the field worth cultivating. Skirting around the side of the new orchard, the path narrows further and borders that of our immediate neighbours. It is heavily overgrown with brambles and hawthorn, and after just a few more paces, it is only then that the foliage falls away and we see our house, filtered through the leaves of a walnut tree and glowing golden in the afternoon sun. It is then that I feel I've arrived, that I'm home. The walk from the station to the house only takes a matter of minutes, but as a journey of the mind, that alone cannot be measured. After 17 or so years living in the village, I've become familiar with just about every tree, every rock, and every turning that upon seeing them can instantly bring to mind some incident. I feel that I've become, like everyone here, a means of channeling stories, that my life is embroiled in the village culture, and that I've moved from being an observer to one who participates. A memory will often spring to the front of my thoughts as my mind wanders back to recall an occasion in detail. Tempered over the time I've spent here, these thoughts return fresh and within easy reach. The past returns and inveigles itself into my present.